Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Today, it is my pleasure to present Xing Li. She has been an intern in our research group for the last 3 months. And her project was dynamic loudness control for in-car audio, which she is going to present now. A little bit about her. Xing is a PhD student in University of Washington across the pond. Her advisor is Professor Les Atlas. And without further ado, Xing, you have the floor.
Thank you, Eva. Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming. This is my end of internship talk. Let me take this opportunity to thank a speech research group for a great summer and to Windows Embedded for Automotive Tube for founding this project. I'd also like to thank my fellow interns for their help and the friendship. Here are the outline. First, I will describe the project. One key point about this project is that loudness control is not just about a volume adjustment. It involves multiple aspects of the hearing perception. I will talk about this in a moment. One key question about this project is that what's the preferred listening level for music, for speech, in different scenarios? I will present the user study results and describe the loudness control systems we have developed. For each system, total we have developed 3 systems. For each system, I have prepared sound demos, so you can judge by your own ear. After all the demos, I will conclude and talk about future directions. Now, first, why do we need a dynamic loudness control system for in-car audio? Well, from everyday experience, we know that during driving, the background noise will be constantly changing. As the road and the traffic condition changes from time to time, the car engine itself might generate different kinds of noise. On the other hand, during driving, we would like to listen to some music or radio or get a phone call. So if we have to frequently change the volume, it can be quite annoying. So we ask the question, can we enjoy effortless listening by developing a dynamic loudness control system? Here is the big picture. To design such a dynamic control system, we need a reliable noise estimation. In this project, we assume the noise estimation comes from the audio processing pipeline, which consists of multiple components, including, for example, the acoustic echo counselor. Provided that we can get accurate noise estimation, now the question is how we are going to adjust the amplification gain as noise goes up and down from time to time. Well, before we go through the technical details, let's first talk about the evaluation methodology. Whatever system we develop, how we are going to evaluate it? It would be ideal if there's some objective measurement to guide the design. Unfortunately, the hearing perception is quite complicated and it involves many factors. So for this project, there's no objective evaluation tool. The main evaluation will be based on our own perception and user study. So get ready for lots of listening. There's no objective result in the end. Okay, let's start. Let's talk about volume and loudness. Basically, by adjusting the volume, we are controlling the sound pressure level, which then affects our loudness perception of the sound. First, how do we measure sound level? Normally, sound pressure is constantly changes over time. The effective measure is usually taken as the root mean square of the instantaneous sound pressure over a certain time interval. For example, several seconds. Because sound pressure range is very big and human perception is roughly logarithmic, so dB scale is used. The commonly used zero reference, 20 micropar, stands for the hearing threshold at 1 kilohertz. Oh, at this point I'm enormously nervous. Anyway.
Do you mind if I ask a question?
Yes.
That level is kind of the bottom line of those Fletcher-Munson curves, right?
Yes.
Cool. But it is in audio. Yeah, otherwise, cool. In the underwater acoustics, they have a different P0, P-reference. In some cases, for vibrations, for other types of noises, there are other 0 dB levels.
Oh, right.
But typically, for audio, what when we start to measure in SPL, that's 20 micropascal.
Okay. Cool.
Okay.
Thanks.
Now let's talk about loudness perception. This figure shows the equal loudness contours at the different levels. The x-axis is the frequency, y-axis stands for sound pressure level. Each curve represents the required sound pressure level at different frequencies to evoke a constant perceived loudness. For example, the bottom curve is the hearing threshold. At 50 dB, in order to hear the sound, the level must be at least 40 dB. Whereas at 1 kHz, the threshold is 0. So our ear is less sensitive to the very low and the very high frequencies. The ear sensitivity is not fixed, but rather it's level dependent. Note that the 100 phon curve is relatively flat, which means at high sound pressure level, our ear becomes almost equally sensitive to all frequencies. So what does this imply in terms of sound timbre perception, which is an important aspect for music enjoyment? For example, the mix level for music is normally above 80 dB SPL. For home listening, if we turn down the volume by 20 dB, the perceived timbre will be very different from the original recording. So how do we keep the timbre balanced when changing the playback volume? Well, the technique is called loudness compensation. Basically, we need to find out what's the original mix level and what's the playback level. The compensation gain should be dependent on the difference between the original, should be dependent on the curves of the original level and the playback level. In this case, we take the 80 dB as the reference level. So if music is played back at this level, no compensation is required. But if we decrease the volume, we would need to boost the low frequency and the high frequency to keep them at the same relative loudness level as in the original recording. To demonstrate this, I have a music example for you. Let's listen to a song first at 80 dB, which is roughly the music reference level.
I don't know why I didn't come.
Wow.
I left you by in the house of fun.
Sorry, this is louder than when we tried it
yesterday. It's
try again.
80 dB?
Yes.
I don't know why I didn't come. I left you by the house of fun.
Much better, sorry.
Okay, so now it's roughly 80 dB. Well, let's listen to the same song, but at 60 dB. The difference from here to here, well, definitely you hear the sound becomes quieter, but there's a difference in the low frequency region. So when you're during your listening, please concentrate on the low frequencies. Let me play this.
No, no, I didn't come. I left you by the house.
So the low frequencies compared to other frequencies sounds much quieter. Now let's listen to the same song with compensation at 60 dB.
I don't know why I didn't come. I left you by the house of fun.
So with compensation, ideally the relative loudness level between low frequency and other frequencies, they should stay relatively constant from here to here. So to confirm, to notice this, let me play the 80 dB one again. So just perception is complicated, so I don't know. It's very hard to find the correct terms to describe what I want you to hear. But let me play this.
No, I didn't come. I left you by the house of fun.
It'll be fun today. Anyway. Somehow there's a level jump in the very beginning. I don't know why. Well, next, let me talk about a user study. The goal, the purpose of a user study is to find out what's the preferred level increase as a function of the noise level. Is it different for different kinds of music or for human speech? Here is, first, how do we measure noise level? There are different kinds of measurement, for example, dBA, dBC, which are basically the weighted sound pressure level. To reflect the ear sensitivity at different frequencies, the weighting curve is roughly the invert of the equal loudness contour. For example, the 40 the A weighting, this blue curve, is roughly the invert of the 40 phon curve. Well, the C weighting is the 100 phon, the invert of the 100 phon curve. In our study, we found the measurement in dBA provides a good indication of the noise level. So in the results I'm going to present later, we will use the dBA measurement. Now, before I describe the user study setup, let's review the key factors involved. First, the stimulus type, for example, rock music versus pop ballad. Noise condition, we have car noise recordings from different scenarios. And the third, this is an interesting one, personal preference. Because we all we understand that human, well, individual judgment can be really personal random. But statistically, we don't know, is there a pattern? So let's find out. Here, this is a screenshot of the user study interface. A user controls when to start the stimulus by clicking on the play button. The stimulus is then played continuously. The stimulus can be either one of the four types of music, or it can be a telephone speech or natural speech. Well, the stimulus is played continuously. At the same time, car noise recording will be played in the background. As the noise condition changes from time to time, the user can use the slider bar to adjust the volume until he or she feels most comfortable. Now, this picture shows our experiment setup. The study was conducted in the driving simulator. We used two sets of speakers, one for music, the other for noise, for car noise, to reflect the real situation as far as possible, because in practice, speech and music come from the sound system, but the car noise come from any direction. They don't coincide in space. Totally, we have tested 19 users. Each one did 80 judgments, including 10 stimuli, 8 noise conditions. Now let's take a look at some results. The histogram on the left shows the distribution of the preferred music level inquired. The most common choice is the 75 dB. The red side, on the red side is about a speech. We see a big peak around 65 dB. On both sides, the wide distribution implies that there's a big preference variability in terms of the absolute listening level. So we normalized each user's data by their preference inquired. So now let's take a look at the normalized data. This is about music, how much level increase users prefer as noise goes up from 30 to 78 dBA. Each curve represents one type of music. We did not find any significant difference among those four types of music. Next, this figure is about speech. We do find narrow band and wide band speech the preference pattern for telephone speech is statistically or significantly different from the pattern for natural speech. Basically, we see a larger level increase is required for telephone speech.
What is the difference between wideband speech and natural speech?
Well, wideband speech is sampled at a 16 kilohertz, the bandpass filtered between 50 hertz and 7.2 kilohertz. Natural speech is basically the CD quality speech, the full band. So we did some further analysis and we found music and natural speech, they belong to one group, and wideband and narrowband speech, they belong to another. So we propose to analyze a user's preference by two parts. The first part is the static of personal preference. The second is the dynamic level increase trend. What matters to our dynamic control system is the level increase trend, which can be modeled by a generalized sigmoid function. In this figure, the red fitting curve represents telephone speech. The blue curve represents music and natural speech. The fitting correlation for telephone speech is slightly higher than for music, possibly because for speech, the choice is pretty much dependent on speech intelligibility, in the case of music, it's getting more personal. So the judgment for speech is relatively less subjective, so we get a high correlation. But the fitting correlation for music is 0.76, so it's a pretty decent fitting. Now let's talk about dynamic loudness control.
Can I make
yes.
If you don't mind, back to that curve, just to a little bit of anecdotal validation. When Rebecca picked your tail, trying to decide if reference volume levels for video conferencing equipment and things like that. We did find one thing similar to yours, which is people like to hear narrowband or wideband speech at a slightly higher level than human voice. And a potential explanation from our psychologist in the group who did some analysis was that it is harder to understand sound coming from a machine, and as a user, the only thing I can do about it is increase the volume.
Oh, that's a good explanation.
Thank you.
There is one interesting thing actually in the results if we return back to the histograms to the preferred levels. So people subconsciously try to put the speech signal as loud as the average human voice.
Yeah, it's
they pretty don't
close,
want
right?
the machine to dominate with a louder speech, but with lower speech they cannot understand
quite well.
The music
they enjoy it louder.
Well, the
right?
music goes 10 dB, 10, 15 dB above.
Yeah. Very interesting.
Now let's talk about the dynamic loudness control. Here are the function blocks of our system. Let's start from the bottom. We get the noise spectrum data from audio processing pipeline. We're going to compute the overall noise level. Given a certain noise level, we will find out the gain adjustment based on user preference data, which is represented as a lookup table here. At the same time, we will compute the compensation for the playback level. Gain and the compensation will be applied to the signal before we send it to the loudspeaker. So all the processing is done in frequency domain. One thing I want to point out is the due time constant control. Consider that we get a new noise measurement every 20 milliseconds, and we know the noise level will be fluctuating constantly. Are we going to change the gain following the exact fluctuation of the noise level? Well, the answer is no, because if we update the gain too frequently, this will introduce artificial temporal structure to the signal, which should be avoided for both music and speech. So the attack time basically determines how long it takes for the system to enter full gain boost. Well, the release time determines how long it takes to enter full gain reduction. The choice for those two parameters will be different for music and for speech. We will see later. Next, let's talk about loudness compensation. We take 80 dB as the reference music level. So the loudness compensation, the compensation gain is then dependent on the difference between the 80 phone curve and the curve of the playback level. Because the level at 1 kHz is the common reference for loudness measure, so we normalize the gain by the level at 1 kHz. The gain and the compensation are then applied to the signal, and we reconstruct the signal by overlap at a synthesis. Now let's hear some demos. The first example is music. First, let's listen to it without dynamic control. I hope it won't be too loud. let me start from the middle. So the preset level for music is 75 dB. Let's see how it sounds as noise condition. Well, the background noise is going up and down constantly. Let's see how. Increase the volume slightly.
No, don't touch. It's good.
Okay. Now let's hear.
This is audio talk. Let's play some loud sounds.
Okay. Now let's listen to the same song in the same time varying background noise, but with dynamic control. Well, I hope you like the way the music level is increased gently as noise goes up and decreases smoothly.
Yes.
I want it for my Zoom when I'm cycling to work.
So the noise sample you used is pretty steady state. How does the system respond to impulses? Like you go over, you know, a bump or all the various non-steady state noises that you get.
Well, that's referred to the time constant choice. Mm-hmm. If there's a noise burst that lasts like 20 or 200 milliseconds, it won't cause the gain change because our time constant is on a much longer scale than the noise duration.
Doesn't it contribute to an overall RMS value that would?
Yeah, but it will be averaged, so that you don't want to change the game each time.
No, I understand you don't want to. What I'm curious about is how you differentiate.
It's just by averaging. Look, the time constant is 1.6 seconds to increase the gain.
Right.
This means that if suddenly the noise drastically changes, it will take three times that, 4.8 seconds before you reach 99% of the compensation. So for the small bumps,
so it's progressive.
It is not going to affect much, which is not, and for the music, it's completely okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but this is not the case for a speech when you have a telephone call and you don't want to miss a word.
Now, with Yvonne's introduction, let's hear the second speech. This is a telephone speech in the same time varying noise example. Let me start from the middle.
On the September morning consecrated to the enormous event, he arose nervously at 6 o'clock, dressed himself, adjusted an impeccable stock, and hurried forth through the streets of Baltimore to the hospital to determine whether the darkness of night had borne in new life upon its bosom. When he was approximately 100 yards from the Maryland Private Hospital for Ladies and Gentlemen, he saw Dr. Keene, the family physician, descending the front steps, rubbing his hands together with a...
So in this case, the speech level is at 65 dB. When noise level is low, it's fairly intelligible, but noise goes up, it becomes quite hard to get it. Now let's hear the same speech with dynamic control.
They were related to the this family and the that family. as every Southerner knew, entitled them to membership in that enormous peerage which largely populated the Confederacy. This was their first experience with the charming old custom of having babies. Mr. Button was naturally nervous. He hoped it would be a boy so that he could be sent to Yale College in Connecticut, at which institution Mr. Button himself had been known for 4 years by the somewhat obvious nickname of Cuff. On the September morning consecrated to the enormous event, he arose nervously at 6 o'clock, dressed himself, adjusted an impeccable stock, and hurried forth through the streets of Baltimore to the hospital to determine whether the darkness of night had borne in new life upon its bosom. When he was approximately 100 yards from the Maryland Private Hospital for Ladies and Gentlemen, he saw Dr. Keene, the family physician, descending the front steps, rubbing his hands together with a...
So... our initial system demonstrated its convenience for listening in time-varying noise. Regarding music, we would prefer a slow attack because missing several notes is acceptable, but a drastic level change sounds unpleasant. And the loudness compensation helps to reduce timbre coloration. Regarding speech, a fast attack is preferred because transient noise might mask segments of speech. Now, let's talk about the drawback of this system. One concern is that in order to maintain speech intelligibility in noise, this system will drive speech level high as noise goes up. Sometimes the peak levels can sound really unpleasant. So we ask the question, can we do something more to maintain speech intelligibility without driving speech level too high, especially avoid the unpleasant peaks, which are not just unpleasant, it's not good for the ear health. Another concern is that the user study data might only hold for car noise-like interference. For the current noise, the overall noise level-based design might not be optimal. So these considerations lead us to the development of our second system, the noise spectrum-based loudness control. The processing is still done in frequency domain, but this time it's over the critical bands. Now let's talk about a human auditory system. Our ear functions like a frequency analyzer. Sound comes in through the ear canal. Eventually, it will reach the cochlea inside the inner ear. Here, this picture shows the unrolled cochlea. Here, different frequency components in the sound will excite different parts of the cochlea. This place frequency mechanism is called the tonal topic organization. It seems as if there is a series of bandpass filters arranged along the cochlea. So to describe those auditory channels, the concept of a critical band was introduced in the 40s. Third octave band filters are usually considered as a good approximation to critical bands. Given the noise spectrum data from audio processing pipeline, in this case, we are going to compute the noise level in each band. So we are here now. Once we know the noise level in a particular channel, we can figure out how much boost gain we need for the signal occupying the same channel. So compare this system with our initial design. Here we are computing the boost gain channel by channel, whereas before we compute one gain and apply it to all channels. Now let's talk about how do we compute the boost gain. It's basically illustrated in this figure. The red curve represents the noise level over a critical band. This black curve is the reference level, which is the 65 phon equal loudness curve. Why do I take this 65 phon curve as the reference level? Well, because here's my thinking. Because the speech preset level is 65 dB. So from a statistical point of view, the average speech level as a function of frequency might be approximated by this curve. So the gain with the boost gain within each band will be the difference between the noise level and this reference level. Let's hear some demos. Here on this, we are comparing our initial system with the noise spectrum-based approach. On both figures, the red curve represents the speech, represents the noise level change, represents how the noise level changes, how the noise level goes up and down over time. It's a telephone speech in traffic noise example. On the left side, the green curve represents the output by our initial system. On this side, the blue curve represents the speech level all generated by our new approach. Now let me play the output by our initial system first. It's the telephone speech in traffic noise.
You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heaven, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
It is fairly intelligible, but at the same time, I don't think you will like the peak a lot. Those peaks, those are very unpleasant. Now let's listen to our new approach. The same speech, telephone speech example in the same traffic noise.
The eye and penetrates the brain. You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heaven, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
So from left to right speech, the intelligibility is the same, but the overall level dropped by 5 dB. Well, there the level drop might be even bigger for those peaks. So let's listen to the speech only, which are the signal we send to a loudspeaker.
The eye and penetrates the brain. You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heavens, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
Okay, now let's listen to the second system.
To the eye and penetrates the brain. You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heavens, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
Okay, now let's do some analysis about those peaks and see what's the difference between the initial system and the new approach. So here, on both sides, so we are looking at the long-term spectrum now. On both sides, the red curve represents the noise spectrum. It's a horn noise. The energy is concentrated around 2 kHz. The black dashed line on both sides represent the original speech at 65 dB. The green curve here represent the output by our initial system. Well, the blue curve represent the output by the noise spectrum-based approach. The green bars indicates the boost gain in each critical band, which is basically the difference between noise level and the reference level. One main difference between those two is the in the low frequency, because the noise doesn't have much energy in the low frequency. So with the new approach, we won't boost the low frequency much. It's unnecessary. So as we see a big peak here, there's about a 10 dB drop here. So that's why the peaks with the new approach, the peak levels are noticeably low. Let's listen to this one. Let's listen to this segment again, taken from the previous example.
Don't also fall in love with a person going on and on about.
Oh, it's this audio system will generate a big trouble for me.
Don't also fall in love with a person you were going on and on about.
So the main message here is we can maintain speech intelligibility in noise without driving speech level too high. So a lower speech level, means a lower audio power, which probably a minor effect for car audio.
So when you're doing it per band, you're essentially filtering the signal. So isn't there, it seems like there's some risk between perceptually changing what the person is actually saying, right, versus...
The sound timbre will change, but the intelligibility won't, because, what I did not go through is, we have the boost gain per band, and this boost gain will change over time as noise changes, but we apply a due time integrator to smooth the gain to avoid introducing any artificial temporal structure to the signal. I guess your concern is talking about if we change the spectrum of the speech, will that modify the intelligibility or affect the intelligibility information? Is that your concern?
Well, if you're not doing it very short time, then you won't change the perceptual quality. Uh-huh. You won't change intelligibility, but it's just the perceptual quality.
The sound timbre,
you're going to add some spectral tilt to.
When you're on a phone call, what you want, intelligibility or high quality?
Yes.
Well, for what it's worth, when you listen to it with the noise, mm-hmm. The perceptual quality is, it's pretty good. But then when you listen to just the speech by itself, then you can really, that's
hear
when
the artifacts. Yes.
That changes so much.
It's natural critical band, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. Since we are trying to, solve the problem for listening in noise, so.
So we're
alright. this noise spectrum based approach has the advantage of maintaining speech intelligibility without driving speech level too high. This approach, because the dynamically changing filters might, as Mike pointed out, it will modify sound timbre, so it won't be suitable for music. So far, the loudness control is only based on noise. We haven't made any use of the signal yet. So we ask, can we do something even better? For example, because of auditory masking, there are some frequency components in the playback signal. We won't hear it anyway, so why bother to make them louder? On the other hand, there are some frequencies in the noise that won't mask our signal, so why try to overpower them? So let's first talk about the auditory masking in human perception. There are basically two types of masking, spectral masking and temporal masking. Spectral masking is normally known as a simultaneous masking. This figure shows the interband masking, where the masker and the signal, they occupy the same auditory channel. This figure shows the interband masking, where the sound in the low frequency generates masking towards the high frequency. Regarding temporal masking, forward masking refers to the phenomena that what happens now affects what happened in the past. This is observed, but the underlying, the mechanism is not well understood why this happens. What happens more frequently is the post-masking. Basically, a louder sound at this moment will affect what's coming next. Let's go through this. We have, as before, we have the processing flow from noise spectrum, but here we are computing the masking pattern generated by the noise. On the other hand, we have a processing flow from the signal. Here, we're going to compute the masking pattern generated by the signal and identify which components in the signal is audible if there's no noise. So in the center block, the boost gain will be dependent on how much do we need to keep the audible peaks stay audible if noise is present. So let's talk about how do we compute a masking pattern. This figure shows, I see you, Rico was.
I remember those curves.
Yes, this is based on my learning from your book.
You just copied from Rico's book.
No, I found that. I generated this by myself. Well, this figure, okay, let's walk through this. The blue curve represents the speech spectrum. We can see the harmonic peaks. The red curve represents the masking pattern in each band. We can see only the strong peaks will be audible, while these weak components will be masked. Consider temporal masking. So this is the, we can compute the masking pattern in frequency domain. Now, taking this threshold, we are going to apply a dual time constant integrator to reflect post-masking the well, the choice of the release time constant should reflect post-masking. As for the attack time, it basically affects how quick we can turn up the gain when noise goes up. Now let's talk about the boost gain. Let's assume we know the noise masking pattern and we know which signal components are audible. How much boost gain do we need to make the signal stay audible? I think it's an open question. So in the experiments, we boost the signal peaks to be 3 dB higher than the noise masking threshold. Now let's listen to some sound demos. Well, we have in the previous slide, we have already listened to those two columns. So I will just play those. It's the same with narrow band speech in traffic noise example.
The eye and penetrates the brain. You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heaven, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
Now listen to the speech only signal. It's the one we send to loudspeaker.
The eye and penetrates the brain. You want to tap the shoulder of the nearest stranger and share it. The stranger might laugh and seem to enjoy the writing, but you hug to yourself the thought that they didn't quite understand its force and quality the way you do. Just as your friends, thank heavens, don't also fall in love with the person you are going on and on about to them. You are on the verge of entering the wise, provoking, benevolent, hilarious, and addictive.
Okay, so the message here is we can maintain speech intelligibility in noise, But at a moderate speech level, the most important point is that we can avoid the very unpleasant high peak levels. Because consider when the background noise is already overwhelming, we don't want to listen to speech at a high level to overload our ear. So avoid those unpleasant peaks and keep speech at a moderate level is very important from a perception perspective. Now, let me conclude what we have done so far. From the user study data, we found there's a strong relationship between the preferred listening level and the background noise level. So that justify it's possible to design a dynamic loudness control system that sounds pleasant. The relationship is different for music and for speech. Based on the user data, we have developed our initial system. This system has demonstrated its convenience for listening in time-varying noise. This system has advantages, but at the same time, it has drawbacks. The main concern is to maintain speech, the high speech level, it might output when noise goes up. So to overcome the limitations of this initial system, we have developed the noise spectrum-based loudness control. The processing is based on critical bands, and we have demonstrated that speech intelligibility can be, we can maintain the same speech intelligibility as the previous approach, but keep the noise, but keep the speech level at a moderate level. From here to here, the processing gets a little bit more complicated. The auditory masking-based approach depends on both the noise and the signal. Well, so far it sounds to me, or to some people, this approach and this approach sounds fairly similar. They also are equally intelligible. Although this approach, since we consider the auditory masking, it can drive the speech level even lower. I want to say the message again, a lower speech level, not just about a lower audio power, but also it's from a perception perspective, it's a lower level is good to our ear health, and it sounds pleasant. Let's now talk about a future direction. There are some very important parameters, for example, the time constants. The choice in those examples are based on informal listening by members in our group. So in the next step, we will need to run formal user study to verify the time constant choice, the thresholds, all the parameters, what's the optimal choice for what's the optimal choice for speech, for music in different scenarios. We need to verify those parameters. A second point is, so far in the examples we see, we can maintain speech intelligibility at a lower level. We need to verify this by running more formal tests. The third point, this is a little bit tricky. So during the auditory masking based approach, we computed the masking pattern. And based on the auditory masking pattern, we computed the boost gain. But as we change the boost gain, the masking pattern changes in at the same time. So it's unknown if there is a better approach to calculate the boost gain. The fourth point will adapt for practical use. If we want to build this in the product, I think the set a power limit to meet the health requirements is very critical. And in some scenarios, when the noise level goes enormously high, we probably would to do something more human. For example, shut down the whole system instead of, you know, generates a really loud speech or music, which probably less optimal. So that's all my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Shane. Questions, please.
Shane.
Yes.
So to estimate the noise level, you must have a microphone, right?
Yes.
And that's presumably the microphone that people use for communicating.
Yes.
So that when I'm having a conversation with you, I'm in the car, is that measured? That should be measuring my signal. But how does it know it's my signal and not the noise?
That's an advanced problem in the audio processing pipeline. The system should be smart to figure out is there a near in the talker. If there is, they should freeze
there's
the system.
Audio acoustic echo cancellation with double talk detector. We update the noise models only when no one in the car is talking and there is no sound from the loudspeakers.
But let's say we are talking on the phone, and you're quiet, I'm talking. I'm in the car.
You are the local.
I'm in the car,
okay.
And you're quiet, you're just listening to me.
Yep.
The signal that is picked up is presumably just my signal. Yep. How does the system know that it's not the noise?
there is a voice activity detector which is combined with the double talk detector, and we.
But the double talk detector should be doing nothing, right?
Because okay,
there is not
but,
no.
But
sound.
There is a voice activity detector. This is part of the noise suppressor at the end. I know when the local person is talking. I know when I have a loud signal in the loudspeakers.
So the noise that you're measuring is the noise in the cabin?
In the cabin.
How can you tell the noise, like the child in the background making noise from the speaker or from the truck?
Well, that is noise, right?
Yeah. How is that different than my voice, which is not noise? How is
so,
that different?
There is a voice activity detector. If there is a signal which statistically goes above the threshold, it is not considered when we estimate the noise model. Because we need the noise model, not only, this is kind of a side effect, we need the noise model for noise suppression, we need the noise model for acoustic suppression. So there is a quite sophisticated system for building the noise model in the sound capturing system.
So if there is a person in the passenger seat talking, is that considered?
It will not be considered as a noise.
Okay.
To a certain degree, if it goes statistically too low and too close to the noise, at some point it will start to average it. Otherwise, it will be feedback. Yeah, the system starts, the music
right,
starts louder,
right.
You speak louder, and then...
Another point, you know, that you highlighted on future direction, so I wonder how much you guys thought about that on power limits. One approach could be borrow some of the techniques that radio stations use, right? Because they do heavy compounding.
Yeah.
So I think with a little bit of compounding, and compounding also has the benefit of driving less the amplifier and the speakers, because as you try to compensate, you may get significantly close to the limits where the distortion would go very high.
Mm-hmm.
But if you apply, in addition to all of that, you put some compounding on it, you might drive the actually peak levels to lower levels and then improve fidelity overall as well.
So we tried with clean speech Rico, and it kind of works. It doesn't with the telephone speech, it's already heavily compounded.
Because it came kind of that way.
It is already heavily compounded. So technically it may have a good effect on text-to-speech when you want to maintain the prompts audible and understandable, but for telephone, it's heavily compounded. You just see the peaks are equal on the spectrogram.
Yeah, because it may have been through a law and
it's all in the
happening.
So how computationally complex is this?
The initial system is a fairly, I think the computation load is fairly light for the initial system because all we want is compute the, this is the second approach. This one, we would recommend this one for music because all we want is take the noise spectrum, calculate the overall level dBA, and take a look at the user preference data and adjust the gain. The user can always reset the preset level because some people prefer louder music, some people prefer soft music, so they can always change the preset level. All we are doing is change the dynamic level, the dynamic level increase trend.
Because I know Andy knows my code base. This is the per frame voice activity detector. That's it. The simplest, the stupidest voice activity detector is pretty much equivalent of computationally wise to the first C system.
So how complicated is the per band gain control based on
this one? This one.
Go the way of the last one. How complicated is that one?
How many bands we have?
I think for telephone speech, like between 250 and there are, you know, this is a third octave band, like a something around below 20, I believe. There are
so
less than 20.
Less complex than the per band voice activity.
Well, that's not hard, but okay.
It's not.
It's just like
nothing of a computational concern here.
Okay.
Besides converting the speech, the loudspeaker channel to frequency domain and back, which you do anyway for the acoustic class.
Cool. I want it tomorrow. The music is really, that's really good.
Cool. How would that work with, I have a soft top mustache. How would this work with soft top? Ciao.
Don't want to start the result, we don't.
Yeah.
We should try. And see, maybe there should be some.
needs to borrow your car.
Yeah, I was going
to
say.
Thanks for the Alex. Do you guys have any windows embedded for automotive, some car with open top? Can I borrow them
next
summer?
Next year.
Perfect. Around spring, I will agree to borrow for the summer.
Summer, maybe.
With regard to your different attack times for speech and music, mm-hmm. So assuming I'm not having a phone conversation, I'm just listening, mm-hmm. and there's music and speech, mm-hmm. How does your system identify
music or speech?
Yeah.
But again, that everything
doesn't.
Comes from the audio
processing
pipeline.
So radio, for example, if you have a radio talk show, it is considered the same as music, and mm-hmm. you may miss some certain points.
Right. So better to err on the music.
Yes.
The slow attack side.
Yeah. But that may not be that critical when you have a phone call.
Yeah.
So pretty much radio, CD, media player, this goes through the time constants and settings for mm-hmm. music, and wideband speech is there. Mm-hmm. The phone call, the settings for speech are for the phone call channel and for the text-to-speech. Okay.
Did you try different music genres with each other to see if some music genres with like typically longer phrasing and things like that would respond differently to different attack times? Or?
Go back to the chat.
I would think that maybe rock or pop as opposed to say mm-hmm. chamber music might be
exactly different.
What I asked.
So you're talking if there are differences in terms of the time constant in the dynamic control for different types of music. Or are you talking about the relative level increase trend that will
be
different?
Yeah, just assuming that like that different types of music is not like a constant mm. thing. There's some music is very busy and has lots of attack transients mm. in it, lots mm. of percussive mm. Impulses, and other music is very much the opposite. Mm-hmm.
Something I did not present is in the four types of music, the difference between pop, ballad, and the rock is much bigger than. You know, this is sort of the two very different music. We almost want to say there's a significant difference between them, but the mm-hmm. since we have only 19 users, so we set the significance test level as 0.01. But the difference between them, if we set a threshold at 0.05, we would conclude the pop ballad, which has a wide dynamic range of music, is a significant different from the rock music. So I guess to answer your question, I wouldn't, although this set of data concluded that there's no significant difference, but you know, it's a human preference. In order to give a confident answer, I think you need to run more tests to find out if there a statistical difference.
I should just include it in the user studies and to see, do we see a statistically different? The settings for now, I'm not saying that they were just for Nora Jones, but kind of see.
We know what's on your Zoom.
I'd also like to add, if the noise is so heavy that the automatic loudness change is significant, then it's not a situation where you worry about the attack of the
right.
piano. So yeah, there's no way to treat classical music with it because you would completely destroy it.
Yeah, well that was the other question. So, does the system cap out at some point? We don't continue to compensate, right?
Mm.
Yeah, it's like,
yeah. So for example, in my
car, he takes the top down on his car. You're gonna quit trying to like destroy my speakers, right?
In my personal car, this system would be very helpful, but I concluded that it's just not possible to listen to classical music in my car.
Yeah,
that's it. Just too noisy. So,
too large dynamic range. Actually.
Mm-hmm. So in the situation where we apply heavy processing, it's not hi-fi. You just maintain audibility of the music, but it's not studio quality. Definitely.
How do you determine how far to go?
You mean how?
How much? What did you call it? Optimal gain, basically.
The designers of the car already decided this because you have some maximum power.
Okay.
Unless you added some additional loudspeakers and
right, because you're just trying to achieve my preferred optimal listening volume, right?
And at some point, you hit the maximum of the audio system of the car, and that's it. Mm-hmm. If it was necessary to have more power, presumably the car makers would put it there. Of course, there are people that have seen cars with 300 watts audio system with a subwoofer which is under the driver's seat, so when there is a drum, the driver kind of jumps, but...
Yeah.
Well, that's what you have.
More questions?
Just one quick one. I think related to what you said is that if the car happens to be one of those that it's active noise cancellation using the hi-fi speakers, then you've got to be careful how you're going to make noise,
yes.
Your noise, right?
Yes.
And you would then need to adjust
the We may have problems, definitely.
You need to kind of jointly design the two so that one doesn't mess up.
Is there a real car?
Yes. But I think those cars which have active noise cancellation,
already.
They can afford to pay for additional studies.
Oh, absolutely. I don't think it's your car. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, it's high-end stuff. Yeah. Some are saying that others already have them. Yeah.
That's beyond my my horizon.
Just a cure. It's not a typical Microsoft
market.
Yeah,
but it may cause problems. It should be looked
at. All right. Cool.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Xing for the talk.
Thank you.